My fellow New Japan heads, thank you for tuning in to another G1 Climax edition of Chris Black's NJPW Report. I am, of course, your host, the natural Chris Black, one of the voices of the Saturday Night Slamcasters podcast, independent professional wrestler, and everyone's favorite narcissist. On today's show, I will be discussing Night 4 of Pro Wrestling's Greatest Tournament. But before we start, I want you to help show your love and support by hitting that subscribe button. I have vowed to cover each and every night of this tournament. Please help me grow my channel, as I am a man of my word and will bring you each and every review. So, with that out of the way, let's get started. So tonight, we are back at the B Block. But as always, we're going to start the night off with a little bit of action by the Young Lions. We have Tsuji taking on Umura. And I finally figured it out. Tsuji looks like Tajiri. Remember Tajiri? So, match starts off with some mat wrestling, exchanging hold after hold, Umura going after the leg, but gets a rope break. Umura seems to be a little bit more cautious during this match, not wanting to slip up. Tsuji goes for a test of strength, but instead kicks Umura and takes him down with a hard shoulder tackle. Tsuji is trying to overpower him using his strength, which is a good strategy for him. Umura is able to fire back up, start striking back, goes for that patented Boston Crab, but Tsuji fights it, and Umura has to switch it to a heel hook, but unfortunately Tsuji still gets to the rope. Umura fights a suplex attempt, and blasts Tsuji with a forearm, hits the ropes, and gets speared by Tsuji, who's now showing some fire. He hits a running power slam for a very close two count, hooks in that devastating Boston Crab of his, keeping Umura away from the ropes. He sits down deep, and Umura has no choice but to tap out in 8 minutes 13 seconds. Why are they doing my boy like this? Umura has suffered 2 losses in a row. They can't keep doing them like that. Alright, getting into some tournament action. Hiroku Goto taking on Sanada. And again, I'm not digging Sanada's new entrance gear. But whatever. Well, both of these guys need to get on the scoreboard, especially Sanada, who I predict will win the B Block. So they start feeling each other out. The match spills to the outside when Sanada ducks a Goto charging by pulling down the rope. Goto avoids the moonsault, but Sanada lands on his feet. As Goto tries to throw Sanada into the barricades, he reverses it and gets hit into the barricades himself. Goto then charges Sanada, who ducks, and he ends up clotheslining the posts. Sanada starts putting some punishment on that arm, which is already wrapped as is, and works him over as Goto rolls into the ring. Goto was able to fight off the assault by Sanada, and gains a brief advantage. Goto is hit with a dropkick, sending him right back to the outside. Sanada follows with a high crossbody. After some more back and forth, Goto is caught in Sanada's skull and submission, but is able to reach the ropes. Goto nails Sanada with one of his devastating lariats, and we get a little bit of more back and forth action, and a slew of pin attempts and roll-ups. Goto fights out of yet another skull and submission, and reverses it into a suplex attempt, but Sanada hits the suplex, climbs to the top, and misses a moonsault. Both men to their feet, Goto escapes yet another skull in, hits a GTW, and then nails a GTR for the win in 11 minutes, 3 seconds. Damn it, man. Sanada, what's going on, bro? I'm going to have to blame the gear, if I'm going to be totally honest. I think it's the gear. I think it's a curse. Sanada is 0-2 for the tournament so far. Gotta get it together, bro. In the next match, we have Tanahashi taking on Toru Yano. So, you all know, let's get ready for some Yano shenanigans. You know, I want to check out some of Yano's older matches. I heard he used to be an absolute badass before going the comedy route. So, if anyone could recommend some Yano matches for me, some old school Yano matches, just write it in the comment section on some suggestions that I should check out. moving on to Tanahashi, you got to love the showmanship of Tanahashi. Like I said before, he's an absolute rock star. He comes out, his hair's all whipped up. He's wearing colorful ring jackets. Tanahashi, he's in a league of his own. The ref, knowing Yano's tricks, it starts harassing him about hiding tape, so he checks him thoroughly. The bell rings, Yano rolls out, but Tana's not going to fall for that. Yano obviously wants him to follow him to the outside so he can get the advantage and let the shenanigans start. But Tanahashi just stands in the ring like, nope, you got to come in here. So the ref starts to count. Tanahashi, as soon as Yano rolls back into the ring, is not taking him lightly. And you get some nice wrestling by both for a change. But then here comes the turnbuckle shenanigans. You know, one of the funniest spots was Tanahashi grabbing the turnbuckle and does a little bit of air guitar motion with it. But the match ends up spilling to the outside. Tanahashi is jumped and Yano starts walking him up the aisle. You know his style. He's going to take you all the way up, beat you down, tape you up, and then run to beat the count. That's what he attempts to do, minus the tape because he didn't have any. But remember, last year's G1, he had some tape stashed on the outside. So you get both men running back to the ring as the referee starts counting, realizing they're running out of time. And then they start to have an actual match with Tanahashi in control. Yano, however, keeps rolling to the outside. So he must have something up his sleeves. Tanahashi misses a crossbody, gets thrown into the barricade, and guess what Yano pulls out? Some tape from underneath the ring. Tanahashi, however, stops him and starts wrapping the tape around the eyes of Yano, blinding him. But even a blind Yano is still able to beat the count, gets back into the ring, tape still over his eyes. And now, I don't understand. I think Yano must have had an eye. He must have been able to get at least one eye open, because when Tanahashi hits the ropes, Yano grabs the ref. Tanahashi stops the momentum because he doesn't want to knock the ref over. But while the ref's view is blocked, Yano low blows Tanahashi and rolls him up for the win. 7 minutes, 15 seconds. Yano steals another one. A blind Yano pinned Tanahashi. What kind of tournament is this turning into? In the third match, we have Juice Robinson taking on Kenta. Ooh, my first initial thoughts on this match. Kenta's about to batter my boy. I'm not liking Juice's chances in going into this match. But Juice looks like $1 million. He's got superstar written all over him. I believe these two guys were in NXT together, but guarantee you would not have gotten a match quite like this in NXT. Kenta starts out with the usual coward opening. Every time Juice approaches him, he ducks his head between the ropes, so the ref has to back him out. And then as they're circling each other, getting ready to lock up, of course, Kenta rolls back outside. Juice goes after him, and bad move, because you know once Kenta rolls in, as soon as you try to follow him, he's gonna start dishing out some punishment, and that's exactly what happens. He starts getting stomped by Kenta. However, Juice is able to recover quickly, starts to nail those straight jab dusty-like punches, but Kenta rolls right back out and walks over to the announce booth and rubs the briefcase. What is that supposed to be, for luck? Is that like Buddha's belly or something? So we get Juice climbing into the ring, and he gets caught between the middle and top rope. Kenta gives him 3 stiff kicks to the chest, then climbs to the second rope and gives him a stiff knee drop. Juice's head, Jesus Christ, bounced off of the mat. So I see what type of match this is going to be. And Kenta commenced to beating Juice Robinson. Starts working over his head and neck, and as Kenta normally does, he starts taunting Juice, kicking him in the face. Juice starts getting pissed off, and as he gets back up, he fires off some straight left jabs, but he is taken right back down. Mocking the Juice claps, Kenta is able to hit a tornado DDT off the top rope, except he didn't go to the mat. He goes over to the outside, lands on the apron, draping Juice's neck on the top rope. That's a very innovative way to hit a tornado DDT. Back in the ring, Juice is able to fight up, and he goes for a superplex. And oh my god, this combination was... Kenta hits him with the headbutt, drops him with a drop kick, hits a Yakuza kick into the corner, runs back, and hits a stalling Shibata drop kick into the corner, then climbs the top rope for a double stomp. Oh, fuck. Even after all that, he still couldn't keep Juice down for a three count, who caught Kenta slipping and nailed one of his full Nelson bombs. Both men to their feet, they're now trading forearms. Kenta, however, hits him with two, painful-looking back fists. Goes for a discus clothesline, but Juice catches him with one first, then picks him up and hits the Juice box for a two count. He starts taking down the straps. He calls for the Pulp Friction, which we all know, when you call for a move, you're normally not going to hit it. And he doesn't because he gets rolled up, and I thought Kenta was about to steal one, but Juice is able to kick out. As Juice is standing up, Kenta hits him with seven open hand strikes to the face, picks him up for the go to sleep, but he loses his balance and almost drops him. Getting back to his feet, he picks him up once again for the GTS. As he goes to land it, Juice grabs his legs, hits the left hand of God twice, picks him back up, and delivers the Pulp Friction for the pin in 17 minutes, 1 second. This is a big win for Juice. Kenta is comforted by holding his briefcase. Juice is pointing at the case and looking at Kenta saying, "That's going to be mine in a matter of time." Juice, I suggest you stay concerned with the tournament and not on that briefcase. In the next match, we have Yoshihashi taking on Evil. And Evil is becoming one of my favorite competitors. You know, I said earlier that I wouldn't underestimate anyone in this tournament because anything can happen. But let's be real, Yoshihashi ain't winning. Evil sits in a chair in the ring as Yoshi comes down the aisle. And when he enters the ring, Evil takes a swing at him. But Yoshi uses his staff that he walks down with to take Evil down. He even starts choking Evil with the staff. Yoshi gets rid of the staff, and Red Shoes calls for the bell. Yoshi unleashes a flurry of forearms to Evil into the corner. The preemptive strike seemed to have backfired as Yoshi aggressively takes control until he hits the ropes and Dick Togo trips him, pulls him to the outside, throws him into the barricade. Now here comes some Bullet Club shenanigans as Evil starts to pile up some chairs and suplexes Yoshi right on top of him. Rolls back in the ring, expecting the ref to count him out. But we all know Red Shoes don't play that. So he doesn't count Yoshi. And as he's waiting for Yoshihashi to climb back into the ring, Evil quietly removes the turnbuckle padding. When Yoshihashi rolls in, he takes more punishment and gets thrown into the exposed buckle, and Evil starts working the back. Yoshi is able to fight off Evil a little bit, even taking Evil off his feet, putting him on the defense. He climbs up to the top rope, but Evil hits the ropes, which crouches him, and executes a superplex. Oh, fuck yo back, Yoshihashi. Back in control of the match, he throws him two more times into the exposed buckle before delivering a darkness falls for only a two count. And I'm actually surprised Red Shoes countered that, knowing that he threw him into the exposed turnbuckle, which is, it's not a secret. He knows that the turnbuckle is missing. He attempts and everything is Evil, but is countered and thrown headfirst into the exposed turnbuckle twice and is followed up by a super kick, but Yoshihashi cannot go for the pin because he is just out of it after that beating he's been taking so far. Both men get to their feet, Yoshi getting the upper hand, and he drops Evil with a fisherman buster for a two count. He then applies the butterfly lock, but then has to release it when Dick Togo jumps on top of the apron and Yoshihashi knocks him off. Puts Evil back into the butterfly lock in the middle of the ring. And he does a pretty good job keeping Evil away from the ropes. And again, the way they made it look, I really thought Evil was either going to eventually pass out or tap out. because he was in this hole for an extremely long time. As far as a match goes, easily 2 or 3 minutes in this hole. Well, I don't know about all that, but easily about 2 minutes in this hole. Every time Evil tried to get to the ropes, he and Yoshi dragged him right back to the middle. So I'm like, there's no way he's going to get out of this. He's either going to tap out or pass out. But eventually, Evil does get to the ropes. But the toll has already been taken. Yoshi almost pins him, hitting a dragon suplex and then a running double knees. But when he goes for a second dragon suplex, Evil grabs the ref and all three gets backed into the ropes, where Togo nails Yoshi in the back with a chair. Even after all that, Yoshi's able to recover, but then he gets low blowed while the ref's back is turned once again and is finished off by Everything Is Evil for the pin in 17 minutes, 21 seconds. You know, I'll give it to Yoshihashi. This is a hard fought match, but 2-on-1, not good odds. Dick Togo, always going to be there for Evil. Again, 2-on-1, you're not really going to win that. Now we get to the main event. We have champion Tetsuya Naito taking on Zack Sabre Jr. Seems like Zack Sabre Jr. didn't exactly learn. His cockiness has returned and returned with a vengeance. He's walking down the aisle looking like king shit. Naito comes out, you know, wearing that white suit. I kind of don't like how he drags the belts. I know that's his thing, but I'm still kind of don't like that. It's kind of disrespectful. He throws the titles into the ring. Zack disrespects the titles even more by stepping on both of them and kind of kicking them to the side. Naito decides to take his sweet time disrobing. Man, so the two lock up. Zack Sabre Jr. moves around like a damn spider monkey. So we get some pretty good chain wrestling, which plays right into Zack's strengths, who has a reverse and a submission for just about any situation. Naito is able to finally put some distance between himself and gains a small advantage, but gets caught showboating and Zack pounces. He rolls and does that tranquilo pose, and Zack pounces on him rather than waiting and throws him into another submission. Zack is in control pretty much the majority of the match thus far, tying up Naito and stretching him. Naito needs to keep his distance. He needs to strike and move, strike and move. Finally, Naito's able to gain the advantage with his unorthodox offense, and he slows Zack's attacks down and even puts him in a submission hold of his own. But Zack does get to the ropes for him to break it. For the first time, Naito has the advantage during this match, but then Zack cuts him off while hitting a devastating tornado DDT out of nowhere, locks in another submission. Naito eventually gets to the ropes, and they go to the outside. Naito hits a neck breaker off of the apron, rolls back in the ring, Naito maintaining the control. They climb up to the top rope, and Naito hits a Frankensteiner, taking Zack Sabre Jr. down. This match is incredible. Zack Sabre Jr. shows that he can hang with just about anyone, well, except for Evil, who just beat the shit out of him in the last match, even though he eventually didn't win. Naito locks Zack into a submission. Again, the Wily submission specialist gets to the ropes, and Naito has to break it. He gets Naito in a submission hold and really starts cranking the arm. I'm thinking he's going to make Naito tap. I don't want to believe it, but I'm thinking he's going to make Naito tap. I get a message from the announcer saying that they've hit the 20-minute mark. And I'm like, will this be our first draw of the tournament? Naito hits one Destino, which doesn't put Zack away. Goes for a second, but Zack counters it into a Zack driver, who almost catches Naito in the same pin that he beat Evil with, trapping the arms. I forgot what it's called. I'm going to have to look that up. Both men want to put each other away before the time expires. They're going back and forth trying to finish each other off. Zack goes for a Zack driver again, which is countered into another Destino's for a very close two count. Getting back up, Naito delivers another Destino's, this time nails it, gets all of it, and gets the pin in 28 minutes, 28 seconds. We are a minute and 32 seconds shy of getting our first time limit draw. But in the end, Naito does beat Zack Sabre Jr. very interesting night. Got a lot of matches to choose from. I really enjoyed Juice Robinson versus Kenta. I really like Yoshihashi versus Evil. And of course, Zack Sabre Jr. versus Naito. Tough decision, but as far as match of the night goes, I'm gonna have to go with Juice versus Kenta. I really like the sheer brutality of the match. Kenta holds, he pulls no punches. He was beating the shit out of Juice. Juice was able to fight back up and eventually outsmart Kenta and take him down. So my match of the night, Juice Robinson. I'm pretty sure everyone else is going to say that they liked the Naito Zack Sabre Jr. match or even the Evil Yoshihashi match. And I'm not gonna dispute that. Those were two really awesome matches, but I'm just going to go with Juice Robinson and Kenta because I really liked that mix of styles. I really liked the physicality of it. Just all in all, great match. And with that, that is the end of night 4 of the G1 Climax Tournament. I want to thank you for tuning in to another edition of Chris Black's NJPW Report and want to remind you once again, please show your support by hitting that subscribe button, hit the like button, share with all your fellow New Japan heads out there. And if you want to follow me on social media, my links are in the descriptions to my Instagram, Facebook, as well as my Twitter. And if you want to, you can also show the Saturday Night Slamcasters some love. There's links in the description that will take you to our podcasting host on Budsprout, as well as the Saturday Night Slamcasters YouTube page. Won't you show us some love there as well? Help us grow that channel. Hit that subscribe button. Again, every single subscription is very much appreciated. And oh, before I go, let me run down the points as of right now for the B block. All right, so in 4 points, you do have Juice Robinson and Tetsuya Naito tied. At 2 points, we have Hiroku Goto, Zack Sabre Jr., Kenta, and Evil. And still trailing with 0 points, Tanahashi, Yoshihashi, and Mr. Sanada. Disappointing, disappointing, disappointing. But hey, it's still early. Anything can happen. Remember last year, Jay White lost, I believe, his first 3 matches and still came back to win his block. So, this tournament can be as unpredictable as the weather. So, I'm ready for the rest of the action. I'm sure you're ready. Be sure to tune in next time as I cover all of the other nights of the pro wrestling's greatest tournament. Until next time, this has been Chris Black. Come get slammed.